It's Song Talk Radio.
Welcome to Song Talk Radio, the show with songwriters talking to other songwriters about the craft of songwriting. We share tips, tools, and techniques, and together we all become better at writing songs. I'm your host, Neil Modi, and with me, my co-host, Phil Emery. How you doing, Phil?
I am doing very well, even though it's been raining solidly for the last week, but I'm still here and, for the moment, dry.
At least it's dry in your studio there, which is probably a good thing.
Yeah. When we moved here, we actually we brought a humidifier because in Toronto it would get very dry.
Yes.
So we have a humidifier, but there's no point in having a humidifier here. No. We can't sell it because no one wants a humidifier.
Exactly.
Here, yeah.
You probably need a dehumidifier, if anything.
Yeah, that's what we got. That's where I am.
There you go. All right. Please send your comments and questions, everyone, to at Song Talk Radio on Facebook or Instagram, or feedback at songtalk.ca for the email, and we'll share your thoughts on the show. And please visit songtalk.ca to see the show post for this episode, to find links to resources we mention, and to download lyric and chord sheets to follow along with the songs that we feature. Tonight, we're very happy to welcome to the show songwriter and author Jimmy Dunne. How are you doing, Jimmy?
I'm fantastic. Thank you so much for having me.
Great to have you on
really
the show.
Really appreciate it.
Yeah, calling in here from California. So we're coast to coast to coast. Well, two coasts. Because Phil's way out east and you're way out west. And I'm in the middle somewhere. All right. And just a little bit about Jimmy. Jimmy is the author of Jimmy Dunne Says. And Jimmy Dunne Says is a collection of author Jimmy Dunne's best bite-sized stories that Americans everywhere are spreading and sharing. These stories are heartfelt, smart, and thought-provoking, and some will have you absolutely belly laughing. Some stories about navigating everyday life today, some that take you right back to your childhood days. You'll see why stories such as downsizing virtually swept the country, about discovering the one thing you didn't know you had, enough. Or stories that will have you laughing out loud, taking you back to your first dates, stories about the art of being a father, essays that you'll be sharing with your friends and family and friends. One thing's for sure, they'll remind you of how truly blessed you are to be alive right now with so much possibility knocking on your amazing door. Awesome to have you on the show, Jimmy.
Well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. It's great, and it's also a pleasure to have to be on a show that celebrates the wonderful art of songwriting.
Yeah, absolutely. And I know your book doesn't really touch on songwriting per se. I mean, I did enjoy reading it. It was a nice, you know, spiffy kind of quick read, and very you know, good sense of humor and wonderful stories and a wonderful sense of positivity to the whole thing. And I actually pulled out a couple of there was one thing that I highlighted in your book that was towards the end. We're talking about one of your teachers, and you said, "Told me to write something that looked like a mirror, opened my eyes to the essence of creativity." And I'm just hoping you can expound on that. What do you mean by the essence of creativity?
Oh, what a great thought. Well, thank you for finding that and saying that. I appreciate that. You know, I guess it's just that I think with whether it's songwriting or it's any kind of poetry, painting a picture, writing a story, whatever it is, with any art, I kind of goes back to that thing that I think Aristotle was the first one that said that art is capturing the essence of, you know, where how do you write something that you know, as a songwriter that really is an expression of something that's truthful and real in your own life. And I would say, to me, as a songwriter, if there's anything, and as the old guy that I am, that I've learned over all these years, is that at the heart of a good song, it has to be truthful. And part of that is that has to be, or, you know, it sure has a better shot if it's something that is true to your own life in some way that is, you know, that's genuine. And it sure makes it a lot easier if you can write things that are genuine in your own life. I find that it's a lot easier to write about things that I know and I feel. And I have found at this age that sort of the fun is, you know, last time I checked at my age, Beyonce's not calling me, asking me if I've got any song ideas for her next release. That's okay. But I have been extremely fortunate to been reimagining what that art of songwriting is and finding other ways to be expressive in songwriting and make money in songwriting in other ways. And in that, find ways to be expressive and be true to my age and what I know and who I am and live there and not trying to write songs about, for me, you know, 17-year-olds. What do I know about what a 17-year-old is doing now? Why would I try to do that?
So you've, of course, you've written many, many songs, and writing a book, was there sort of a similarity in those two creative projects?
Oh, thanks, Phil. Absolutely. I mean, I think, you know, one thing was with the book, it was very purposefully, it's short stories that they're, in terms of the read of the book, of those stories, they're about, you know, 4 or 5 minute reads. So sort of the same thing as a song. And I always found that that I remember an old songwriting collaborator, guy named Rory Burke out of Nashville, wrote a bunch of great, wonderful hits, Little Good News and a bunch of good, wonderful things, said that songwriters are God's psychiatrists. But he said, you know, he talked about the idea that with a song that you've got 3 minutes to try to tell a complete stranger something and get them emotionally engaged in some way, whether that's, you know, to get them weepy or to get them inspired or mad, something. But how hard is that? And that's the fun, and that's the art of songwriting. And I love that. And I find that with on the book side of life, same challenge. How do you do that with writing a little story? And I think, like with that, very different than poetry. Very different with poetry and lyrics that way. You know, it's not meant to be something studied and that you kind of figure out after the 15th read. No, you got to figure it out in the first read. You got to figure it out while you're listening to it. And I think that makes it very, very different, and very different as a, you know, as a challenge to that art.
What was the decision like to sit down and actually think, I'm going to write a book and publish it? I know you've published lots of music, so you're used to the publishing world, but what was that decision that made you go, you know, I'm going to write a book? Or did you start off with lots of writing and then thought, I'll put it into a book? How did that work?
I've kind of done that my whole life, and I have, writing has been sort of part of one of the plates I've always spun along the way. I wrote, and I was a writer on, this really dates me, on Happy Days and some other Paramount TV hits and shows along, you know, back, you know, then. Just to make note, it was not, it was a period piece show. It was not, we didn't shoot in the 50s, thank you very much. Doing, you know, back from those days of writing, and then I, you know, was a journalism major, but my whole life I've always written for papers and always been in the world of writing. And then where this really germinated from is my town paper, Pacific Palisades, out in California. Will Rogers happens to be from our town, and he kind of got his career started writing this column called Will Rogers Says, that was at the time a kind of a response to the Depression. And there were these positive stories about that that hit a nerve at the time. And so with that, I'm pretty involved in a lot of things in our town. And the editor of our town paper said, as an homage to Will Rogers, would you mind writing a column for us? And we'll call it Jimmy Dunne Says. And it'll be, you know, an homage to him and sort of a little bit of a reflection on and response to these crazy, brittle, you know, divisive times of today. And that was the idea. And then with it, some of them that kind of got out there in internet land just hit a viral nerve. And one of them had 250,000 shares, and another one had about 70,000 shares. And with that, then it got picked up as a book, and then it's distributed by Simon & Schuster. And so off that went. And I had written a children's book before and some other books as well. So I've been sort of swam in that sea a little bit before.
Yeah, like what I find interesting too about the kind of similarities between perhaps songwriting and writing of other forms, like especially the way you did it, like you say, short, snippy, you know, little pop hits of your stories, basically, yeah. Right? And your ability to sort of, you know, really zone in on something interesting in your life, and sort of put a little spotlight on a certain aspect of family life or of fathership or of you know, there's something going on in the town or something like that. And it's in some ways, you know, it's a little bit, you know, the book is a little bit country, like it's a little bit sort of, you know, just sort of espousing about the daily things in your life. And you could almost see how some of those topics would make interesting songs. Cause like you say, like looking in the mirror and really expressing something of yourself but it's more than just, but it's different than say a journal entry or a diary entry, right? Like you're sharing something and you want it to be sort of, not necessarily helpful to your audience, but at least inspiring to your audience or something that they can read themselves, into your thing. So how do you feel about that as songwriting as storytelling, I guess, is the
gosh, question. I love that. Oh my gosh. You guys are, I mean, the thing that is, you know, with that, you remind me, Neil, in saying that, of my daughter when she gave her eighth grade speech, and she said something about, it's actually about Pythagoras, and it was this, because he was a mathematician and also, you know, really into the arts, and he said it was a quote that said something to the effect of that what makes music is it's the space between the notes. It's not the notes, and sort of the idea that I think is all songwriters, as we understand, you know, if you just line up the notes, there's no music. It is the space. It's, you know, it's the bum, 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 bum. It's the space. It's about the space. And I do think that, you know, I find that with life, that the real beauty of it, it's not in the big events. It's not in the, you know, those marker moments of wedding days or those kind of things. It's just in the little sweet, dear moments and those little things that happen along the way. And that, you know, it's the little thing that happens when you're at the grocery store and the lady behind the, you know, that hands you the bakery goods, something that happens that for whatever the reason is, captures just the essence of life or what's wonderful or something. And to me, I love looking for those moments, no different than a photographer does looking for a pretty picture. And I love trying to write about that and to try to find the importance in that.
A lot of songwriters have a book where they jot down bits of conversation or ideas mm-hmm. as they go around. Did you do that in your songwriting as well? Is it sort of the same approach as what you're doing for the writing?
Yeah, I did. I mean, as a songwriter, I would say with songwriting, most songwriting in my life was with was collaborations, especially in the countryside of life. And I did a lot of my life, songwriting life was in the film and television world. And a lot of that was very deadline orientated. So a lot of it was with, you know, collaborations, and it was very mission centric to what you were doing something for. But, you know, and I would say that's not really an answer to the question, but for me, one of the treasures of my life has truly been many of the people that I feel so fortunate to have been able to collaborate with. They're just heroes of mine. As you know, as a kid or just in the journey of being a songwriter. But the art of collaboration to me is just such an amazing thing. And with that, you know, I think part of the duty of it is walking in the door with stuff. And I always felt obligated to walk in the door with melodies that could stand up for whatever something we were working on, whether it was a country song or whatever it was, but also with, you know, with some lyrics as well. And I would say on that front, you know, some of the things that I'm sure you guys have experienced as well, I'm forever amazed at those handful of times, either with collaborators or that have happened to myself, where songs have just shown up and where I was doing one with a guy named Paul Overstreet, a Nashville songwriter. Paul was songwriter of the year for like 5 years in a row, which was just ridiculous, and just incredibly talented guy that I think was born with a guitar on his stomach. And just the greatest guy, couldn't love him more. I walked into it, we were doing a song together and just told him about an idea for a song, but it was just sort of an idea about something. And he just sort of sat there for a minute and then 10 seconds later said, "What do you think of this?" And just played it. The whole thing, I mean, top to bottom. And, you know, the only thing embarrassing about it was like, is my name really going on this thing? And, he played it. And it was like, did we record that? And he finished it. It was done. How did that happen? Where does that come from? And those are those moments, I think, you know, in terms of the process and the collaborative process, or even when you do it by yourself, that it's just the thing that, you know, on the artistic side of songwriting, that you just feel so lucky that we get to do this for a living, to live in the arts and to be able to do this. I mean, how wonderful. It's spectacular.
Yeah, that's really remarkable, and it is extra special when you get into a room with somebody who's like, you know, they always say try and get into a room where you're the least talented person there, because yeah. you'll learn the most, right?
Exactly.
I've been able to do that my whole life.
Yeah, yeah.
No,
the default
but it's
position
true.
Anyway.
It's right? Absolutely true.
Yeah, you know, but at the same time, like that's. I don't know, the collaboration versus doing it yourself. I mean, I wouldn't necessarily equate the two, because it's like you say, like you're no longer looking in the mirror and exposing your true self or
yep.
trying to discover your true self. Now you're working with somebody else who's got all sorts of different perspectives on things
yeah.
and all sorts of things. And what
yep.
can you create together is sort of
yeah.
Sort of a different thing than either one of you would have done by yourself. Right?
Yep. Yep. Absolutely.
Yeah, well, it's music is certainly sort of a magical thing. When you were writing songs, did you always have like a, you said you always came to the table with something. Was that, were they ever sort of fully completed songs, or were they just ideas or a verse or a chorus?
You know, and I most of the time it was parts of thing, because they, you know, I think, like I'm sure with you guys, it's like if you have something that's full, it's like you're kind of holding them, you're kind of holding them to the side because you figure you might as well just keep this, do this by yourself. But usually it was sort of a half-baked thing. And I would say, I think, Neil, even to your point, I think even with collaborations, usually it's somebody's story where the other person's sort of adding to it, but somebody sort of owns it, and it's sort of their thing, their, it's their point of view, and you're sort of adding, you're adding a layer on top of, you know, of their, of their creation, and hopefully being a bit of an editor to, you know, to that, and contributing in, you know, in other ways, whatever, you know, whatever that may be.
Yeah, that's actually very true. Even if you get into a room with a blank page with somebody,
right,
one of you is going to suggest something that that gets the ball rolling.
Yeah.
Right. And then you're right. It becomes sort of their point of view and their sort of genesis of the idea.
Right.
And then the balance shifts in terms of, yeah, are you contributing, or did you, you know, come up with the initial thing and then continue, yep, to contribute? It's different with every collaboration, right?
Yeah. Absolutely. And it's also, I find, you know, it's, at least in my journey, there's been a big difference between, is it writing for a project versus just writing a song? And, you know, where writing for projects, the creative thing that was great about it was you knew what it was for. It's like writing a television episode. You know what it's for. You know what the characters are. You know, it's sort of like a Mission Impossible thing. You know what you're supposed to do. You know, it's like, I know what I'm supposed to do here now, so I got to go do it. And, you know, bring back something that's good. You know, with just writing a song, it's just, you're just making something up, and then you sort of have to finish the pie, and then say, is anybody in the world want this by any chance? And I mean, that's a very, very different process and such a different job. And, you know, where, it's sort of changing the subject with that. I mean, what I have found in my life is, it is, I remember one of my very, very first bosses, it was my television boss, kind of Gary Marshall, who was the producer of a bunch of TV shows. And, but he was my mentor in my early days of TV. And you know, I had said to him one point, you know, how do you, you know, there's guys seem to be really creative guys, and then there's guys that are really sort of good business guys who are producers. And, you know, to be a producer, you know, what's the path? Is it really to be a good business guy, or is it to be a really good creative guy? And he said, well, it's to be a really good creative guy and to be a really good business guy. And I think that's true. And it is with songwriting. The guys, the people that I know, the men and women that have been the most successful, you know, are incredibly talented, both creatively and business-wise. And, you know, I mean, we have, look at the examples we have out there right now on the artist side. I mean, Taylor Swift, I mean, she's a monster as a songwriter. She's a monster as a businesswoman. And Beyonce, you know, they're monstrous creatively and as business people, and go down the list. And, you know, I think those days maybe long, long ago where one could just be, you know, an artsy, craftsy person and let their manager, you know, do things. It seems to me that train is, you know, for the most part, left the station. And that ever more so with streaming and the internet and, you know, and everything in the world now, you gotta be, you got to be great at both, not okay at both. You have to be great, and you better be getting up early, and you better be staying up late. And it's, you gotta, you know, and you got, just gotta be outworking everybody. And I mean, I always get a kick out of, remember watching some, it was one of those, Charlie, blank on the guy's name that, that was one of the guys that lost his, show. It was one of the woke, guys that got put, what was his name, Charlie, that had the talk show, but he had Bill Gates and all the biggest hitters on both the and biggest hitters in the money and the creative world, and you know, it was like six of them in a round table. And he said, what would you say is the thing when, you know, you guys all have relationships with the biggest people, the biggest men and women, you know, in the world, running countries and running businesses and running everything? What is the through line? What do they share in common? And without exception, they said, hard work. That's what they share in common. They all work really hard. And it was just so funny because you thought it was going to be something so enlightening. And, yeah, you
no,
know,
there's no secret sauce, right?
It was hard work.
It's just hard work. Yeah. And then, of course, that applies to a certain extent. And even I would suspect, anyway, I don't want to be a proof either way, but for smaller independent artists, because DIY, you know, like they have to do everything. They don't have the option of having a manager and a marketing team and someone to do their wardrobe and all that other stuff.
Yeah.
You know, and shoot and direct a music video. They have to kind of do absolutely everything.
Yeah.
Themselves, from the songwriting to the recording to the producing, so the,
oh my gosh,
the video production, so the social media, to the business stuff, everything.
Absolutely. And even creatively, you know, where, I mean, when you, you know, dip back into the old days, think of a Linda Ronstadt or something, you know, where the task at hand was to, how good are you, you know, you stand in front of a microphone. That's the job. Those days are over. You know, it's now, it's, okay, well, you did that, but now how, you know, how good are you on Melodyne? And you know, and how's Logic doing for you? And oh, your computer just, you know, crashed, and do you know how to fix that? And how's publishing going? And every just inside of the creative world, how do you know how to put the right, you know, reverb on? And it's just, you have to wear so many creative hats of engineering and arranging and so many things that are required that I don't think were part of it as much, you know, 20, 30, 40 years ago, that are now imperative for most people in the creative, in the songwriting or in the artistry space.
I mean, back in the days, you had someone who was an engineer and he engineered the session, and then you had a producer who produced her, and then you had another person who just did the mastering, and then you had one person who did the arrangements, and you had another
masters, right?
You know, yeah, I mean, you had all these people who, that's all they did.
Right.
A guy just would do mastering like 8 to 10 hours a day. That's all he did.
Right.
Now, it's so hard to get that level of expertise because you have to be able to do everything.
Yep.
And maybe knowing what to do yourself and what to job out, maybe that's the secret sauce.
Yeah, it's a lot.
Well, and it's a lot, but especially for the independents, you know, it's you know, through that ease of, because a lot of it has to do with the ease of technology as well, right? It's just easier to do things and all that sort of stuff. But through the ease of that technology, they're no longer beholden to the big corporation. They can,
right?
They, you know, not you can look at it as you have to do all this stuff yourself. Well, as more of an empowering thing, where it's like, I can do all this stuff myself.
And it's, Neil, I couldn't agree more. It's actually, it's a positive thing. It's the opportunity is you get to do it, and you it is. It's an empowering thing. I think you're absolutely you're right.
Right on. Okay, I'm hearing the exit music there. I think that's all the time we have on Song Talk Radio. Special thanks to Jimmy Dunne. Where can our listeners find out more about you and maybe pick up a copy of Jimmy Dunne Says?
I would say to go to jimmydunne.substack.com, which is sort of my creative home, jimmydunne.substack.com. That's the best spot.
Great. We'll certainly link to that from the show post for this episode. And of course, we want to hear from you. So please send us your comments on Facebook or Instagram to @songtalkradio, or send us an email, feedback@songtalk.ca. Also, be sure to check out our YouTube channel for live performances and full episodes. And subscribe today to the Song Talk Radio podcast on your favorite podcast provider. You can find links to all the products, books, and web services we mention on the show on our resources page on the website. And please join us at our next monthly Song Talk meetup. Whether you're in Toronto for our in-person meetups or anywhere in the world for our online meetups, it's free to join on meetup.com and free to attend the meetup. Bring a song and a lyric sheet and get constructive feedback from other songwriters. Stop by songtalk.ca for the link. You can follow me at neilmodi.com. You can follow Phil
at philemery.ca.
And Jimmy, what's your favorite social media channel? Where do you post the most?
Instagram. Instagram, and I can't remember the address, but Jimmy Dunne, probably you can find me there.
Be sure to dig Instagram. That up and find that as well. All right, and be sure to stop by the website songtalk.ca to browse past shows and find out how you can be a guest. Thanks for tuning in, and keep on writing.
Thank you, guys.
Good night, everyone. Good night.